scripture reading for today is from Matthew 13, verses 1 through 17. It's out of the NIV Bible. The same day Jesus went out of the house and sat by the lake. Such large crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat in it. While all the people stood on the shore, then he told them many things in parables, saying, a farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was gathering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places, where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly, because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came out, the plants were scorched, and they withered, because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants. Still other seed fell on good soil, where it produced a crop of 100, 60, or 30 times what was sown. Whoever has ears, let them hear. The disciple came to him and asked, why do you speak to people in parables? He replied, because the knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom of heaven has been given to you, but not to them. Whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken from them. This is why I speak to them in parables. Through seeing, they do not see. Through hearing, they do not hear or understand. And them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah. You will ever hear, but never understand. You will be ever seeing, but not perceiving. For this people's hearts have become callous. They hardly hear with their ears, and they have closed their eyes. Otherwise, they might see with their ears, and hear with their ears, understand with their hearts, and turn, and I will heal them. Here is the reading of the Holy Word.
Will you pray with me? Thank you, God, for your word, for Jesus' teaching this day, and just pray that by your Spirit you would speak to our hearts, to our lives. Give us ears to hear, eyes to see, and hearts to understand. To hide you behind the cross of your Son, Jesus, O God, that in everything that is said and done, you would be the one seen, you would be the one heard, and the one glorified. For I ask it. Now, just in case you saw Brian Johnson's post on Facebook this morning, it encourages you to get excited about the Super Bowl. But it also encourages you, it says, if you're excited about the Super Bowl, why not have that same excitement in your worship service? Well, he doesn't stop there, though. And this is the part I really want to address. He says, if your pastor makes a point, a really good point, pour Gatorade over his head. Not. It's all right if you want to go touchdown, but let's not do the Gatorade. Dave, our custodian, would really appreciate it if you didn't do that up here on the carpeted area. But anyway, hopefully we can get excited about what God's doing in our lives, not only individually but collectively. And this morning we come to continue to look at God's call on our lives. This morning we come more specifically to look at the question of how am I called? Now, it's been said for the Christian to seriously ask this question, they must first approach it with a personal commitment to both to respond and be accountable to God in the calling. We need to hear that. We need to hear that. For us as Christians, as we seek to discern God's call and then to live it out, we must, not we should, we must have a personal commitment to respond to God and His call and then seek for the rest of our lives to be accountable to Him and to that call as we seek to live that call out. I genuinely hope and pray that we hear that, because I believe far too often when it comes to God's call on our lives, we approach that more lackadaisically. We don't take it as serious as perhaps we really need to. We need to be open to what God has for us, but we likewise, as we respond, we need to understand there's an accountability piece to that call as well. And that accountability is to God and then to His people as we seek to live that call out in service to God and to His people. Now, we might respond and we might seek to be accountable, but often, again, it's on our terms. We might not say that, but that's how that call gets lived out. It's on our terms, not God's. And every time we do that, it takes us away from God's will for our lives. It takes us away from what God wants us to be doing. And even times can take us away from the relationship that He wants to have with us. But too often, we fail to see it. We fail to see it and even fail to understand it. But what we also find on the flip side is when we do seek to be accountable to that call, and we seek to really be listening and be in tune with where God's leading us and calling us, that there's joy in the midst of that. There's joy in the midst of it as we experience incredible fellowship with God and we experience incredible fellowship with each other. The scripture reading that was shared with you just a moment ago might seem a little strange in addressing the question of how am I called, but it's one that I believe speaks volumes for us, and it's one that God has led me to. The passage is the teaching of Jesus on the parable of the sower. In it, He talks about the various types of soil. Soil that a sower is sowing seed in a field, and it hits on all these different types of soil. And actually, there's a whole sermon series just in the parable of the sower, but we're not going there right now. But what He does is He ends that teaching with the disciples asking Him an interesting question. Jesus, why do you speak to the people in parables? What's up with that? Remember what He said? The knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom of heaven has been given to you, but not to them. Whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have even what they have will be taken from them. This is why I speak to them in parables. Though seeing, they do not see. Though hearing, they do not hear or understand. In them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah. You will be ever hearing but never understanding. You will be ever seeing but never perceiving. For this people's heart has become calloused. They hardly hear with their ears, and they have closed their eyes. Otherwise, He says, they might see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their hearts and turn, and I would heal them. It is in this parable that in Jesus' response to the disciples that I believe we find the answer to how we are called. God calls us, I believe, through our very senses that He has gifted us with. But too often, we've allowed those senses to become dulled in a way that we just don't hear, we don't see, we don't comprehend. We're not open to what God has for us. And in that, we miss God's call. Or even if we hear it, we don't completely understand it. What I believe in this parable Jesus is teaching is that we need to be cultivating the very soil of our lives, as well as sharpening our spiritual senses so that we can hear God's call and we can respond in a way that draws us closer to Him and draws us closer to one another. I want to take just a few moments and consider what Jesus is saying, especially when He talks about the senses. He talks about the heart. The heart. He speaks of those who have allowed their hearts to become calloused. Their hearts, He says, has become calloused. We are first and foremost, I believe anyway, that we are called in our hearts. God speaks to our hearts and He calls for us to be in relationship with Him. We've heard this time and again as we've spoke about God's call on our lives. His primary call is into relationship with Himself. But He then, after we establish that relationship, calls us to move on with that call. It's not enough to just have that relationship. We need to do something with it. He moves us, I believe, deeper and deeper into that call as we respond to Him and as we respond to His people. Wesley called that working in our hearts prevenient grace, God's grace wooing us into a relationship with Himself. And when we come to that place where we understand that grace and accept it, it's called justifying grace, and we move on. We seek to grow in that grace. I don't know about you, but I can look back on my life, and especially before I knew Christ as my Lord and Savior, as I look back, I can see how God's grace was working in my life through people, through situations. Until I came to that point where I realized that God was calling me into a personal relationship. And from that point, God doesn't stop calling. His grace doesn't stop working. He continues to move us on and to call us on down the path. We can never be satisfied with saying, well, that's enough. God doesn't have anything more. He does. And He calls us on. In Revelation 3:20, it tells us that gives us the words of Jesus where He says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. And if anyone hears my voice, anyone hears that knock and opens the door, I will come in and we will have fellowship together. We will have relationship. And you see, friends, God is one who keeps knocking and knocking and knocking until we're willing to open that door. And I believe the same is true as He calls us to move on in that call and to live that call out. But again, it depends on our hearts and how open they are to receiving what God has. In the Gospel of Mark, in the 7th chapter, starting with verse 5, we find there the Pharisees questioning Jesus about His disciples and their eating before performing the hand-washing ritual. Here's what He says to them. They ask him, why don't your disciples follow our age-old tradition? They eat without first performing the hand-washing ceremony. And Jesus says, you hypocrites! Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you, for he wrote, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. Their worship is a farce, for they teach man-made ideas as commands from God. And Jesus wasn't necessarily saying that the ritual was wrong, but what He was trying to make them understand was that their focus and their emphasis was on the wrong place. While their rituals were right in line with what they believed God wanted and really what God had told them to be doing, their hearts were far away from Him because all they could see and all they could get locked into was the ritual, going through the motions. You ignore God's law and you substitute your own tradition, Jesus says to them. And then He goes on to say, listen and try to understand. It's not what goes into your body that defiles you. You are defiled by what comes from your heart. Jesus wants them, and he wants us to understand that it's far more important for us to worry about what's going on in our hearts, to worry about the condition of our hearts, for that's what drives our outward actions. But too often, we get it backwards. We worry about the actions, and we forget about the heart. In Proverbs 4:23, it tells us there, above all else, guard your heart. Above all else, above everything, guard your heart. For it is the wellspring of life. Remember what Paul writes in Romans in the 10th chapter, starting with verse 9, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and what? Believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Thanks for no Gatorade. And friends, the parable of the sower is teaching about the receptivity of our hearts and our lives to God's word, and ultimately to him. How am I called? I'm called in my heart. You are called in your heart. The question becomes, what type of soil is your life, and how receptive are you to what God's trying to plant into your life by his Spirit? First, calling you to a personal relationship with himself, and then calling you to a life of service. Another, Jesus speaks about the ears. He speaks of those who have allowed their ears to be closed so that they could not hear. They hardly hear with their ears, Jesus says. In John 16, starting with verse 13, it says, when the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will speak. He will not speak on his own, but will tell you what he has heard. He will tell you about the future. He will bring me glory by telling you whatever he receives from me. At times there are those who want to know, does God speak in an audible voice? Does God speak audibly to us? Can I hear God audibly speaking to me? And I believe that there are such times. But I believe more often than not, it's God speaking to our hearts and to our spirits, where we hear him not so much with our physical ears, but with our spiritual ears. If I go back to my own conversion experience, I remember hearing God speaking to my heart, his word of grace, of mercy, of forgiveness, of relationship, of love. And did I hear him audibly? No, but boy, did I ever hear him with my spiritual ears. And I don't believe that God stops speaking from that point. He continues to speak by his Spirit. He tells us that in his word, as the Spirit continues to teach us, to guide us, to lead us. And in my own personal faith journey, I sense God continuing to speak to my heart about how I was going to serve him and his people, and that ultimately led to hearing his call to full-time ordained ministry. Now, God speaks to each and every one of us. We need to be open to listening to what he says. Does he tell us all the exact same thing when it comes to relationship? Yes. When it comes to how we live out that relationship and how we especially live it out in service, in our call, he speaks to us, I believe, in different ways, calling us to do different things for the body of Christ, for the upbuilding of the body of Christ. The point is, we need to be open and open to listening to Him as He speaks to our hearts. We need to listen with our spiritual ears that we might hear. In prayer, we need to ask God to help us to have spiritual ears that we might hear what He's saying, and to help us to be careful that we're not simply hearing what we want to hear. And even maybe going so far as to putting words in God's mouth. God, this is what I want you to say to me. And that's only what I'm going to hear, is what I want to hear, not what you're telling me. We need to go back to the teaching about the different types of soil. How open are we to receiving His Word? How open are we to receiving His Spirit? How open are we to receiving His call, to really hearing Him? And not just hearing, but responding. We need to likewise ask ourselves, when we do hear God speaking, are we willing to listen? I mean, really listen. There's a big difference between hearing and listening. I can hear you when you talk to me, but that doesn't necessarily mean I'm listening to what you're saying. And let's be honest, every last one of us can recall a situation, and maybe even as early as just today, a time when someone was talking to us, and when they stopped talking, we find ourselves in big trouble because we're not exactly sure if they just asked us a question, if they just made a statement, and how do I now respond? And how do I get myself out of this mess that I'm now in? We need to hear, and we need to listen. Finally, Jesus talks about the eyes. He speaks of those who had closed eyes, so that their eyes could not see. His exact words, they have closed their eyes. How am I called? I'm called through my eyes. God opens my eyes to behold Him face to face, to behold His glory again and again and again as we come into relationship with Him and live that relationship out. But then likewise, I believe He continues in that call to open our eyes that we might see His world, that we might see His people in a way that we've never seen the world or His people before. And I think oftentimes that's why we want to close our eyes, because God, if I really allow You by Your Spirit to open them, I'm not sure I want to see what You're going to show me. And so it's easier to just not look. John 2:23, Jesus says to Nicodemus, I tell you the truth. Unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. Again, the problem can easily become that we do not want our eyes open, because once they are, we really will never be the same again. We can't unsee what we've seen. I truly believe that even when we are open to the call of God, He opens to our eyes too. His call in ways that we can begin to see His hand at work, leading us to be His hands and feet in His world. Sometimes I think He does that in very blunt ways, and sometimes maybe that's in more subtle ways. And that's why we need to be prayerful as we ask God to open our ears and our hearts and our eyes. I think I've shared with you probably one of the most graphic demonstrations of God opening eyes and giving an actual physical look at what He wanted was in a church I was serving. We were seeking to move into an area of mission. We were supporting a lot of missions. But we were beginning to feel led to move into a country that fell into what is called the 1040 window. It's where The Christian faith is least practiced. And where the Word of God cannot be proclaimed openly without some very real danger. We went to meet with a missionary friend that we knew down in Wilmore, Kentucky, and we were on our way back, and one of the things he shared with us, we weren't sure where God was going to lead us, and he said to us, "What do you think about India?" Never thought about going to India. Thought he might call us to go to Africa, though. India? Interesting. On our drive back home, the chair of missions and I had gone down to talk with this gentleman, and we were discussing, "Do you think God's speaking to us? Do you really believe this is what God wants for us?" The words no sooner came out of the mouth of my missions chair when I looked at the van sitting in front of us. And he had vanity plates on it. LTSGOC. Let's go see. I said, "Jim, see that? I don't think God could be any more clear. I don't know about you, but I'm going. Because I think God's telling us, beyond a shadow of a doubt, I want you to go to India." And we formed a partnership with them and made trips to India. God blessed us beyond our wildest imagination. And that partnership lasted a long, long time. In fact, it was still in place when I left that church. And I still know the director of the ministry there. We need to be open to what God has for us. And I've seen that happen in other instances where God continues to show us where he wants us to be if we'll just look. Just like the other senses we have considered, we need to ask ourselves, how willing am I to really see what God wants me to see? If we're not careful, we can be very selective in what we see and what we don't see. There's a big difference between looking and actually seeing. I can look at a lot of different things and never see what is really before me, because I'm looking beyond it. Or maybe I'm just choosing to see what I want to see, because if I focus in, I'm going to get attracted in. When it comes to these spiritual senses, we must understand that they are not so much that they're there one moment and then they're not there the next. These are such that they continue to grow and become sharpened as we grow in our relationship with God through Christ, and as we allow the Holy Spirit to indwell us and to continue to teach us, to guide us, to direct us. And I even believe that sometimes it's not until we are willing to step out in faith and by faith that these senses will come alive. What we come to understand from the parable of the sower and Jesus' response to the disciples following that teaching is that God speaks to us in a very real, and he speaks to us in a very powerful way, calling us into relationship with himself, calling us into relationship with his people, and calling us into service in his world to be disciples of Jesus Christ, that the world might be transformed through him. When we hear the call and respond, we begin a journey that will continue, my friends, for the rest of our lives. But too often, if we're not careful, we can give up on it as we decide we're going to take a break or perhaps even a detour. If we're going to be honest, we might have to admit that too many times were like those Jesus was referencing when he quoted Isaiah saying, "For this people's heart has become callous. They hardly hear with their ears, and they have closed their eyes." And it might not even be intentional. It just might be a result of the way we choose to live our life of faith and the way we choose to live out our relationship with God. Friends, God is calling us. He is calling you. He's calling me. He's calling us. But we have to have our hearts open to receive all that he has for us. And first and foremost, his Son, Jesus Christ. We have to have our eyes open so that we can see him face to face, that we can see the need of his people, of his world. And we have to have our ears open that we might hear him speaking to us through the power of his Holy Spirit. How does God call us? I believe he calls us through our senses as he calls us to have our hearts open to receive, our eyes open to see, and our ears open that we might hear. And as we seek to live out our call, God promises to never leave us alone. But Jesus himself gives to us the promise, "I am with you always, even to the end of the age." But remember, he said that after he called his disciples and he calls us to go into all the world and to be the hands and feet of Christ. As we come to Holy Communion this morning, we come to celebrate the relationship that God offers to us through Christ. But I believe it likewise becomes a time for us to hear anew God's call on our lives to be in relationship with him. God's call on our lives to be his hands and feet in his world. And I pray that as we come to the Lord's table, it becomes a time of celebration. But I believe it also becomes for us a time of response. It becomes a time when perhaps we even make it our prayer that God would open our hearts, that God would open our eyes, that God would open our ears, that we might live our lives as disciples of his. All of our days. Will you pray with me? Oh God, we give you thanks and praise for the senses that you have blessed us with. Forgive us, we pray, for those times when we have allowed our hearts to become calloused. Forgive us those times when we have shut our eyes because we just did not want to see. For those times when we've looked past what it is that you were trying to show us. Forgive us for those times when we've closed off our ears and refused to listen to what it is you were trying to speak into our very spirits by your Holy Spirit. Help us, we pray, to be open to all that you have for us, that we might be faithful disciples in the name of your Son, Jesus. That we might be about transforming your world, not in our power or might, but in his and in his name. We thank you for this blessed sacrament that calls us to remember all that Christ has done for us, but likewise calls us to go into all the world. It calls us into relationship with you and with each other. May this truly be a time of not only remembering, but celebrating and even answering your call. As we ask these things in the name of your Son, Jesus.